Sir, something between washing or cleansing, the specific substance is ingested through mouth and enters in the stomach. And this process either produces vomiting or sometimes there is a no vomiting. In Vastra Dhoti there is a no vomiting. In when you are doing Danda Dhoti there is a no vomiting. But when you are taking water and vomiting, then there is an act of vomiting. There may be or may not be vomiting. Without any hazard, it is very important. What is the difference between pathological vomiting and physiological vomiting? Vomiting is also physiological, it is also pathological. Pathological means in that vomiting, if you have suffered from stomach pain, severe abdominal pain, if there is a some blood through your mouth or through your vomitus, if there is a severe colic, if there is a dehydration, if there is a giddiness, then we can say this vomiting is a pathological vomiting. But you think that sometimes when you have got indigestion, at that time also there is a vomiting, vomiting for one or two times. But surprisingly, after that vomiting, you feel freshness, you feel lightness. So such vomiting is a protective process. You see, this type of vomiting is a protective process, and it should be taken as a physiological. Also, sometimes diarrhea, when you have got indigestion due to some heavy ingestion of some heavy material, you have got indigestion, and there is a fermentation of all this food matter. And there is some little abdominal pain, and there is a frequency of stool, and there is a diarrhea for 2 to 3 days. But after that loose motions, you feel better. You feel very lightness. So that should not be taken as a pathological diarrhea. That should be taken as a physiological diarrhea, because it is a cleansing process. So it is a replace given by your body for purpose of protection. So we have to excrete that fermented matter, that toxic matter. So in Dhauti, if there is a vomiting, it is a physiological vomiting. So Dhauti physiological vomiting, it is not pathological vomiting. Science of pathological vomiting, just we have discussed of pain, weakness, giddiness, digestive disturbances and dehydration. There are 3 types of dhauti: vaman dhauti, danda dhauti and vastra dhauti. Vaman dhauti means taking a water, plenty of water, and there is the act of vomiting. That is vamana dhauti. What is the danda dhauti? Taking the water and then ingest rubber tube, and through that you excrete all the matter from your stomach. That is the danda dhauti. And third one is the vastra dhauti, means ingest the vastra. It goes in the stomach and gives massage and some gentle friction with the mucous membrane of the stomach, and then there is a cleansing of the stomach. See the woman. But you know, all your life experience with this woman. You see the act of vomiting. You see, if you see how the vomiting starts. Technique of vaman dhauti. Now you know the technique, so don't waste the time in the technique. That take warm water, add very few salt in it, drink in such a quantity till the sensation of vomiting starts. So there is a sensation of heaviness in the abdomen, some pressure in the stomach wall, and then there is a nausea, and then there is an act of vomiting. So lean slightly forward and insert one finger to touch the part of soft palate, so as to create the mechanism of vomiting, and this start the vomiting reflex. Now what is the physiology of vomiting? Now what happens? You know, when you ingest the water, what happens in the stomach? You see, this is your esophagus, this is your stomach. You know, here is a sphincter, here is also a sphincter, and here is. So at the top of esophagus there is a sphincter, here is also a sphincter. When you eat some lunch or dinner here, then there is a closing of the sphincter. So that the food matter, when there is a movement of food matter, liquefaction of all these solid food after meal or after lunch. So there is a too much movements due to the contraction of muscular wall of the stomach. But this food matter cannot come into the esophagus usually physiologically because of the closing of the sphincter. Now what happens? When you take warm water in a huge quantity, what happens? There is a filling of the stomach and slowly, slowly there is a bulging of the stomach. Okay? And that water gives mechanical pressure to the walls of the stomach. See, due to the ingested substance, there is either irritation of mucosa of stomach or distension of the stomach. But when you take lukewarm water, there is no irritation of the stomach. You see, sometimes when I take some spicy food in very small quantity, at that time it gives too much irritation to the stomach wall and it creates the act of vomiting. But here is not like this. So here is no irritation to the mucous membrane of the stomach. Here is only giving mechanical pressure. Okay? There is a distension of stomach. See, in Vaman Dhauti, in Vastra Dhauti, there is another mechanism that you can see. But in Vaman Dhauti, when you are ingesting water 1 liter or 1.5 liter, what happens? There is a distension of stomach and it gives mechanical pressure on the walls of the stomach. And it, what happens then? It gives impulses to the vomiting center in the medulla oblongata. It is very important. Now, we know this is the upper part of brain, this is pons, and here is the medulla oblongata. And from this medulla oblongata, vagus nerve arises and it supplies to the three systems main: digestive system, respiratory system, and circulatory system. To the heart, to the lungs, and bronchitis, and to the digestive system. Now, one impulse goes through this vagus nerve to the medulla oblongata, that something is, some matter comes in the stomach and there is a too much distension of stomach and we feel uneasy. Now, due to this sensation, here is something happens and the vomiting center here, it activates and it gives message to the vagus nerve, throw it up. Now, that message cannot pass only through this in this region. That is, only that nerve which supplies the stomach. It gives the message to overall vagus nerve. That is the beauty. You see, it stimulates the vagus nerve overall, all the branches of vagus nerve. And when that vagus nerve is stimulated, so throughout, it works in the respiratory system as well, it works in the circulatory system as well, and it works in the digestive system also overall. So wherever that vagus nerve supplies, there is action. And so whenever there is a reflex of vomiting, just we are generating that reflex of vomiting by adding some water in the stomach also. But the result, a resultant effect is on overall all the systems, since the overall vagus system is active. And so there is an act of vomiting, so throwing of all this liquid to outside. So medulla gives returning impulse to the upper GI tract organs, diaphragm and abdominal muscles. This combined work produces vomiting. But at the same time, since the vagus nerve is activated, it acts on the respiratory system also. You know, when you are vomiting, also there is a secretion from the nose. Also there is a secretion of mucus, you see, some mucus. Also there is some act of mild cough. Also there is a secretions or there is a coming out of the various mucus bilgum from your bronchus, from your trachea. How? Why? Because of the stimulation of that vagus nerve. You know, when you are vomiting, in the act of vomiting, you see the pulse. There is an activation of pulse. And there is a pulse goes from 72 to 80, 90 sometimes. For some time. So that indicates the activation of heart and increase of heart rate. For some time. It is due to the activation of vagus nerve. Same thing happens in the liver, in the pancreas, in the esophagus, in the stomach, in the diaphragm, in the small intestine, and in the lungs and some, and in the bronchial. So we will see step by step what happens in all these systems. But basic thing is, that is the stimulation of vagus nerve. So mechanism of vomiting, what happens? After a deep inhalation, opening of upper esophageal sphincter, here, opening of upper esophageal sphincter, so that is the actual act of vomiting. What happens at that time? Opening of upper esophageal sphincter, closure of the glottis. Why? So that the the vomited matter from your stomach does not goes into the trachea in the bronchium. Then elevation of soft palate. So soft palate closes your nasal cavities, so nasal openings inside. And then contraction of diaphragm and abdominal muscles, very important. There is a post-school contraction of diaphragm and abdominal muscles. It gives slightly exercise to the diaphragm and abdominal muscles. And opening of lower esophageal sphincter then, and squeezing of stomach. That stomach, expanded stomach, suddenly squeezes. And squeezing of that stomach expels the matter. Here is the pyloric sphincter. Here is the closure of this pyloric sphincter. So that when that stomach squeezes, and when there is an opening of this sphincter, what happens? All matter comes towards the mouth, and then there is a throwing of the all this water from the stomach. So squeezing of stomach between abdominal muscles and diaphragm, and thus matter get expelled through mouth. So just simple procedure, you are taking water and you are expelling water. What is the purification? Where is the purification? Only if you purify your throat, purify your esophagus and stomach. Yes, that's not like that. Because by this act, you are activating your vagus nerve. You are activating the medullary centers. And so, through activation of vagus nerve, you are cleaning the respiratory system, digestive system, and circulatory system.
Is it the vomiting that activates the vagus nerve, or is it the vagus nerve that stimulates the vomiting?
It is the vagus vomiting center that activates, because vomiting center is in the medulla oblongata. And firstly, there is an activation of vomiting center. Now, why there is an activation of vomiting center? By giving the stimulus from your stomach. And now, vagus nerve is sensory as well as motor. So, that sensory stimuli also passes through the some branches of vagus nerve which supplies to the stomach. So, that sensory impulse also passes through the vagus nerve. But once it goes here in the medulla oblongata, there is an activation of vomiting center. And it gives stimulation to the vagus, now expellitum. So firstly there is an activation of vomiting center. It is very important.
First point.
You see, Abhimay, see this is a vagus nerve. There are so many branches. So from one branch there is a sensation that there is too much matter in the stomach and there is a pressure, there is an uneasiness. And so there is an activation of this center. Now this center activates the vagus nerve over all the branches.
Yeah.
Not a specific branch. Okay. That is the main thing.
Yeah.
So it does not activate only this branch. It activates overall vagus nerve. And so we take the benefit of overall activation of the vagus nerve. Okay? So that is the mechanism of vomiting. So these are some precautions. You know that what precautions we have to take before dhoti, that it should be practiced early in the morning without taking food. Then water should be clean. Adjust the quantity of salt according to the condition. If the patient is hypertensive, then don't add more salt. That is a part of your practice. Proper position during vomiting. See, proper position is very important. You know, don't stand in erect position while there is vomiting. Just relax your sit in the erect position while you are vomiting. In the act of vomiting, and rest after the process. So since there is a higher work of your muscles and diaphragm, and as well as the activation of vagus nerve, it is better to take the rest for 10 to 15 minutes or 20 minutes after the act of vomiting. Contraindication, yes, we must think about the contraindication. Then we will see the effect of all this dhoti on the organs and tissues. What are the contraindications? First contraindication is the peptic ulcer, bleeding peptic ulcer. Because if there is an ulcer means here is the wound in the mucous membrane of the stomach and also in the muscular wall of the stomach. So when there is a peptic ulcer, don't do such vigorous process, because due to the forceful squeezing of the stomach, there may be possibility of bleeding. There may be possibility of that non-repair of the wound. Okay, there is a too much bleeding in the wound, acute inflammatory process in the GI tract. Acute inflammatory process, if there is an acute gastritis by taking some spicy food, by due to indigestion, acute, not chronic, in acute gastritis. Then varices in esophagus and stomach, that is due to the liver failure. You know, the chronic alcoholic person, he has a liver failure. And so there are some branches of your vena cava which opens in the stomach, and there are varices, and so there is a small bleeding tendency into the stomach. So when in such a patients, if you give such a vomiting, there may be possibility of bleeding. Okay. Then pregnancy and during menses, that is very important. During menses also, it is better to avoid during menses, but before and after we can.
Why is that?
Just now, see, in the menstrual, when there is a starting of menses, it is not matter when you are doing vomiting, because there is no bleeding tendency in the stomach. But usually, in some patients or in some persons, in some ladies, it may cause too much weakness, because sometimes there is a gripping pain in the lower abdomen. Also, there is a tendency of pain while you are doing some hard procedures. So it is better not to do some hard procedures during menstrual period. Not only woman dhoti, but also some other, that lifting the weight too much. So avoid the hard procedures during menstruation. But if it is a suitable form, that after some vigorous practice or after regular practice, if it is a suitable, then it doesn't matter.
So it's just because of weakness?
Just because of weakness. Okay. So if that lady is anemic, then it becomes more problematic. Otherwise, see, if you are a regular practitioner of the Vahana Dhoti, it doesn't matter, because there is no, if it becomes familiar process, then it becomes, it doesn't matter. You can do it. During acute infection, so whenever there is a viral infection in the respiratory tract or everywhere in the body, don't do some hard procedures, because it increases the hard procedures, it loses the energy from your body, or it may increase the fever, it may increase the bleeding. Yes?
What about if you had food poisoning or something that you
eat
was bad,
but
you
know,
is it good to do it?
Yes, whenever there is an acute poisoning by ingesting some other particles, here is, this is the therapeutic procedure for that, stomach wash. What we are giving stomach wash is nothing but your rubber, what you, danda dhoti. Also we are putting some rice tube and we washes the stomach. So in such ingestion of some toxic material, it is the therapeutic procedure. So we have to give it. Or in weight loss or very weakness, if the patient or if that person feels weakness, anemia, so don't do dhoti for that time.
But weight loss, how much weight loss and due to what?
Weight loss due to any chronic diseases.
And
anorexia also. Anorexia and weight loss associated with the weight loss and weakness. Weakness due to, now sometimes it has post viral fatigue. After viral infection, there is a fatigue for 1 or 2 weeks. So that is a condition of weakness. So in the condition of weakness or weight loss, don't try to form the heart procedure. Now you know the role of vagus nerve. So the effects of vomiting are related to all these organs and associated systems. You know, since the vagus nerve supplies. So there are 2 vagus nerves, from right side and from left side. See the 2 vagus nerves, which comes from the medulla oblongata, supplies the respiratory tract, heart, and then it perses the diaphragm, supplies some part to the diaphragm, then comes to the stomach, liver, and here in the pancreas, and one branch goes also to the kidneys. So it is a global nerve. See here. Now here is this diagram. You see, this is the medulla oblongata, you see, the part of the nerve. Here is the vomiting center. And this is vagus nerve arising from medulla oblongata. It gives supplies. See the supply of vagus nerve, because now we are concerning about the effects all over the body. See, that effects happens where the supply of vagus nerve is. Now see the pharyngeal muscles. your muscles of your pharynx, muscles of your pharynx, then muscles of your neck, your vocal cord, see the trachea and the bronchial tree and the lungs, and then heart, main vessels, and then comes to the diaphragm, stomach, small intestine, and part of liver and biliary system. So this is the all work of vagus nerve. So these are the organs which are influenced by the stimulation of vagus nerve. So effect on the stomach. First effect we will see on the stomach. What happens in the stomach? First is due to throwing of that water with some waste products which are in the stomach. If there are some unnecessary, unwanted materials in the stomach, they are thrown with water, and so there is a good stomach wash. Sometimes what happens, you see, when you have cough, not 100% cough is excreted by your act of cough, like this. No, some part of phlegm is ingested through your esophagus, and it comes in the stomach, but still it is a very sticky, it does not process from the stomach towards the intestine, and so it gets attached up to your mucous membrane of the stomach, and so we have to remove this phlegm. Now during the act of vomiting, because when you are ingesting some heavy water in large quantity, what happens? There is a fullness in the stomach, there is a stretching of the mucous membrane. At that time, that phlegm or that waste product gets connected with the water, or some part liquefies, and it thrown out to the from the mouth. So that is the stomach wash. So mucus, phlegm, and food particles are thrown out with water. You see, food particles. Some are hair-like food particles. You see, sometimes some hairs or hair-like particles come with the food. When you are eating some vegetables or fruits or other food matters, some unnecessary, unwanted particles come in the GI tract. You see, that are very difficult to mobilize, and they may remain for a long time inside your stomach or inside your intestine. Now this is the time that when you are doing some cleansing process, so there are too many chances or more chances to expel all these unwanted hairs and other things. So in such conditions, as compared to woman dhoti, vastra dhoti is very important, because in vastra dhoti there is no expansion of stomach. Instead of expansion, there is a constriction for the protective purpose, and that vastra and the muscular mucous wall of the stomach, there is too much friction, and due to that, some particles which are attached to the mucous membrane of the stomach get attached to the vastra, and they expel, especially hairs. And so that is the nice cleansing by vastra dhoti. Then mucus cells. Now see, due to removal of extra mucus coating, the cells which secretes gastric juice get activated, and thus proper secretion of your pepsin and hydrochloric acid. You see the stomach. This is the mucous membrane. You see, when there is no food in the stomach, then there is a mucosal folds. You can see here. Now, if there is an unwanted material in the stomach for a long time, what happens? It gives lethargy to these mucosal cells. Because what is the function of these mucosal cells? Secretion of some hydrochloric acid. Firstly, formation of hydrochloric acid inside the cell. And then it is a secretion whenever the food comes in the stomach. So we have to give enough time for the formation of hydrochloric acid, or we have to increase their ability for the formation of hydrochloric acid and pepsin. It can be possible when you are clearing stomach. What happens otherwise? If if there is an indigestion, some fermented matter comes here in the stomach and it remains. Sometimes what happens after heavy meal, again you take some regular meal, what happens? Some part which is in the intestine, and there is a process of digestion in the intestine, and you are taking some another food. But due to indigestion or due to delay in the process in the intestine, that pyloric sphincter cannot allow this material which we have taken from the mouth to go to the small intestine. Now it remains more than 2 hours, more than 3 hours, more than 4 hours in the stomach. What happens then? There is over secretion of hydrochloric acid, there is a disturbance in the pH, and then it starts to ferment here. And due to that fermentation, it irritates the mucosa, or there is a lethargy to the mucosa, and that is the problem. So there is a nauseous and sensation, fullness sensation. But what happens? Here is the main process, that in small intestine, there is a still process is going on, and you are adding some another material, and here it gets fermented. So usually your irregular diet habits makes this problem. If you are taking diet in proper quantity and in proper time, then it doesn't matter. But usually what happens, due to irregular habits, it happens that some part of the food which is in the small intestine, it is still in the process, and you are taking some food which remains in the stomach for a long time, and it disturbs your gastric mucosa, and so there is a lethargy to the gastric mucosa. Now due to cleansing process, what happens? All this unwanted material which remains in the stomach get thrown to the outside, and so there is a clearance, and that clearance gives the freshness to the mucosal cells. So due to removal of extra mucus coating, the cells which secrete gastric juice get activated, thus proper secretion of pepsin and hydrochloric acid. And what happens in the muscular coat? You know, the stomach has 3 layers. Inner one is mucus layer, which secretes mucus and hydrochloric acid and pepsin. Middle layer is for the movement of the stomach, that is the contraction, that is the muscular coat. And outer one is the sclerotic coat, that is for protection. What happens in the muscular coat? So increases circulation. So while the act of vomiting, there is a forceful contraction of the muscular layer, at that time there is an increase in the circulation towards the muscular coat, and thus decreases the lethargy of stomach muscle cells. There is a lethargy, because when some fermented matter remains in the stomach, there is no movement, because of there is a delay in the digestion of small intestine, and so there is a lethargy to your muscular layer of the stomach also. But due to this vomiting act, due to the all this removal of the unnecessary matter, there is an activation of your muscles, and it reduces the lethargy in your muscles of the stomach. You see, this is that if you take this stomach, the inner one coat is the mucus, middle coat is the muscular, and outer one is the sclerotic. So there is an action on the mucus membrane, there is action on your muscular membrane. So it acts on mucus membrane also, it acts on the muscular layer also. Now effect on the small intestine, what happens? Now see, you know the term peristalsis and antiperistalsis. So that is the pathway of food from your mouth to the anus. So the motion from mouth to anus is it follows the gravity. So the motion which follows the gravity is the peristalsis. But in vomiting, it is the anti-gravity action. So it is an antiperistalsis. So during vomiting, there is a formation of antiperistalsis, not only in the stomach, not only in the esophagus. Since there is an overall activation of esophagus nerve, there is an antiperistaltic movement in small intestine acts. And also there is an opening of this sphincter. Now see, opening of this sphincter. Now here is stomach and here is small intestine. You know. Now here is small intestine. Now if the patient who has indigestion and too much fermented matter in the small intestine, which doesn't go upwards and which doesn't go downwards also. Why it doesn't go upwards? There is no path since the closure of your sphincter. And it doesn't go downwards because still the process is going on. So in delayed digestion, yes, there is a fermentation of these food particles, but we have to remove this. What happens due to that antiperistalsis? Now some branches of vagus nerve supply to the small intestine. Now there is an opening of this sphincter, and there is an antiperistaltic movements in the small intestine also. So all the fermented matter in the small intestine, all the fermented matter, undigested matter, which doesn't go upward or which doesn't go downward, due to opening of the sphincter, it comes in the stomach and it gets thrown to your mouth. So that is the cleaning. So in Vaman Dhamni, it is not the cleaning of only your stomach. So you can wash out your unwanted fermented particle which is in the small intestine. But not, see, but not the large intestine. Why? So, don't worry, that fecal matter cannot come to your mouth. Why? Why?
Throwing shit to the mouth.
What happens, see?
Because the sphincter is closed.
See, what happens, you see, that branches of vagus nerve comes to the small intestine. But see, the large intestine is supplied by the sacral parasympathetic branches, not by vagus. So you are ascending colon, descending colon, and transverse colon, and rectum. It is not supplied by vagus nerve. And so, we can expel the matter which is in the small intestine. We can expel the fermented particles which is in the small intestine. We cannot expel the matter which is in the rectum or which is in the descending colon. But what happens? Now that we will see what happens, that is the gastrocolic reflex.
That's a what place?
Gastrocolic reflex. That we will see when the action of the gastrocolic reflex. So, due to it is thrown outside. Thus, we prevent the auto poisoning of the body.